The Bible talks a lot about grace, and Christian theology talks a lot about grace. But what does grace mean? Let's talk about that today. Hello, welcome to Clarity and Brevity. Today I'm joined by my friend Dr. David Briones, and he's done a lot of work on grace in Paul's letters and has thought about this in the context of the Bible. So we're very happy to have him on the channel today. So Dave, welcome to the channel.
Thanks, Brennan.
So you've done a lot of work on grace, and why don't we just jump right in here? When people hear the word grace, biblically, what should they be thinking of when they hear that?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think at the core of what we mean by grace is simply one word, gift. That's all it means. But we take our notions of grace and kind of insert them into what the Bible means by grace. And so we tend to use grace by saying, oh, I've done this by the grace of God, or I've been saved by grace, not by works, or God showed me grace. But at the end of the day, we need to understand what it means biblically and not what meaning we insert into that term. So there's a great quote by Bovink who says that all the benefits of the covenant of Christ, the covenant that Christ acquired and the Holy Spirit applies, can be summed up by a single word, grace. But then he says, grace means different things to different people. And that's so true. You find that people throughout church history have used the word grace, but they don't mean the same thing by it. Marcion means one thing, right? Or Pelagius means another. And Augustine means another when they use that term. So biblically speaking, it can mean different things. We're most used to understanding the word grace as something like an undeserved gift or divine favor, gracious disposition, things of this nature. But it usually refers to salvation being given as an undeserved gift. And you see that throughout in the scriptures. You find that in Romans chapter 3, all throughout Romans chapter 5, and so forth. It can be understood as a spiritual gift that gives the gift of salvation. But it also can be understood as a material gift. And that's something that people don't often understand, because they don't usually read 2 Corinthians 8 and 9 on the Jerusalem collection. It's a neglected text, but there Paul says that the giving of money from predominantly Gentile churches to these poor Jerusalem saints is a grace, is a charis in the Greek, a gift. And so grace can mean a material gift as well as a spiritual gift given by God. But it can also be used to describe power. So Paul says in 2 Corinthians 12, 9, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power was made perfect in weakness. Or in 1 Corinthians 15, 10, when he says, by the grace of God, I am what I am, and I worked harder than any of them, though not I, but the grace of God with me. So yes, grace can be a spiritual gift of salvation. It can be a material gift of money. It can be even the gift of power or empowerment. But there's one last definition that's important for Paul, and that's that grace is not merely something, but someone, as John Barclay puts it. It's a person. Grace is Jesus Christ himself. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. You can think of Galatians 2:20, and the life I now live, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Or 2 Corinthians 8:9, all you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that although he was rich, he became poor, so that you through his poverty might become rich. Or the grace of God appearing in Titus chapter 2. But one of my favorite connections is Galatians 5:3-4, where he says that anyone who accepts circumcision is obligated to keep the whole law. You are severed from Christ, you who would be justified by the law. You have fallen from grace. So the severance from Christ is a falling away from grace himself. And so what we find is, like one Valley of Vision prayer puts it, which I love. He says, O source of all good, what shall I render to you for the gift of gifts, your own dear son? He came, God incarnate, to save me to the uttermost, as man to die my death, to shed satisfying blood on my behalf, to work out a perfect righteousness for me. In him, you have given me so much that heaven can give no more. So we find that grace can mean several things to different people, but biblically speaking, it can be a spiritual gift of salvation. It could be a material gift. It could be the gift of power, but most preeminently, it is the gift of the person of Jesus Christ.
So there's in other words, there's a lot of ways that gift is used, and you're bringing some of the cultural context in here as well from the New Testament. Maybe a couple of follow-ups here. That's a lot of definitions, to put it bluntly. That's a lot of complexity. Can you relate some of this, if I can put it this way, this complexity, this multifaceted nature of grace, can you relate that back to the more theological concept you mentioned at the outset, where it's undeserved, but also the notion that it's related to the gospel of grace? And how does this multifaceted view that you're arguing for here, how does that relate to the more straightforward, or maybe that's not the best word, but some unified, streamlined definition of grace that's come down to us in Christian theology?
Yeah, it's a great question, because we've dealt with the question, what is grace? But the even more important question is, to whom is grace given? To simplify the notion of grace, we can speak of it as the gift of Jesus Christ himself that's given to his people, and we receive all of these benefits in him. So union with Christ is essential. But to whom does Christ give himself? That answer is a gloriously scandalous one, because it's not to the people that you think deserve this glorious gift. It's actually to those who do not deserve it, to those who are unworthy, to those who are ungodly, to those who are sinful. And Romans chapter 5 brings this out really well. I mean, we find in Romans chapter 5 that it says, I'm just pulling it up here, for while we were still helpless, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For rarely will someone die for a just person, though for a good person, perhaps someone might even dare to die. Now this is really fascinating. First, it says Christ dies for the ungodly, but then he says, maybe someone would die for a just person, right? Someone who's righteous, or maybe a good person. See, those are elements of worth. You know, the worth that matches the glorious nature of the gift. There is some congruity, right? I deserve this because I'm a good person. And so this gift that's great comes to me. The glorious thing about the gospel is that it goes to people who do not deserve it, the ungodly, the weak. And that's what he goes on to say. He says in Romans 5, verse 8, but God proves his own love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. The self-gift of Christ was given to us while we were still sinners. There is no righteousness, no goodness, nothing that would make us fitting to receive this glorious gift. And that's the scandal that I mentioned of the gospel, that in the ancient world, it would have been scandalous to do that. But God shows his love for us in that those who are weak, ungodly, hostile, and have a total absence of worth, receive this wonderful gift of salvation through the person and work of Jesus Christ, apart from works. It's a gift, and that is received. And what shows us is the great love of Jesus Christ himself. You know, John 15, 13, what does he say? Greater love has no one than this, and someone lay down his life for his friends. But Jesus shows us that great love. He lays down his life for his enemies. And that in and of itself is love vast beyond all measure.
I have a couple more questions here in light of what you said that could be helpful. And one is maybe easier, maybe one's harder. So let's go to the hard question first.
Okay.
I say it's hard. It may not be hard, but it's a discussion about justification. There's been a lot of discussion about justification in the study of Paul's letters. How does this discussion of grace speak to that particular issue of justification in Paul?
Well, when we think about justification, it takes place in union with Christ. And the great exchange takes place, where he takes on our sin and we receive his righteousness. Through union with Christ, we are declared to be justified. All of his benefits that he accrued are reckoned to us. Now, this goes against a sort of Roman Catholic understanding of grace, where it's as if this is a glass of water that's poured into your soul that you then can improve upon, and it, the righteousness gets infused within you, and then you work that out. That's wrong. What we're talking about here is a forensic righteousness that's imputed to our account, reckoned as righteous in Christ, in union.
Just say, what does that word impute mean? Could you just...
Yeah, impute means to declare. It's a forensic term. We are having this righteousness of Christ being reckoned to us as if it is ours, and it is ours through union with Jesus Christ.
So justification is a forensic declaration about what Christ has done for us. And we benefit from that by faith and union with Christ. Am I channeling you well here as I channel the Reformed tradition?
Yeah. And that's Romans 3:23, right? Yeah. That we are justified. Well, actually, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, and having been and are justified as a gift of his grace in Christ. And so we have this connection there with the nature of grace and justification, which is essential, which means that it's not worked for. It's not something that we get partway and improve upon so that we can ultimately get it fully at the end. This is something that's given to us in and through the person and work of Jesus Christ alone.
Yeah. And so for my other question is, as you started out earlier in this discussion with all this multifaceted nature of grace, could you just talk about the benefit of understanding why that's important to understand those various angles you were talking about?
Yeah, I think it's important because, again, we tend to import a definition of grace that is sometimes alien to the biblical text. So, for example, I think a lot of people have this definition of grace where grace is a free gift or pure gift or only deals with the spiritual. But Paul actually relates the gift of grace in Jesus Christ to other areas of our lives, not simply the, we could say, theological, but also the ethical. And so we're talking about the applying grace to the whole of the Christian life lived, if that makes sense, where it's not just initially how we get into or how we receive Christ, but it's also how Christ works his very life through us. And I think that has huge implications for our ecclesiology.
Yeah, thanks, Dave. I hope this conversation has been helpful. Thanks so much for watching. Remember to keep it clear and focus on Christ.